Hello, everybody, and welcome to Seeds of Liberty podcast, episode 26. Before we get into the show, we're going to go with Jeremy for the BIPCOT NoGov license.
Hey, you remember this time. Good job. the Seeds of Liberty podcast is covered by the BIPCOT NoGov license. This allows for reuse by anyone except for governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about this at BIPCOT.org.
Yes, so today we have Raeford Davis, who's a former police officer from North Charleston, South Carolina. He's a voluntarist, libertarian. He's got a blog, which is blueenmity.blogspot.com. You can follow him there, or you can follow him on Twitter, at Raeford D, R-A-E-F-O-R-D-D. And then he's got, where he's featured as the, was it law enforcement officers against prohibition?
That's right. Leap.
Right.
Yeah. Leap. I love them.
That's really awesome. So Raeford, thanks for coming on the show.
Yeah, I appreciate you having me on Seeds of Liberty. This is great. So giving me an opportunity to speak out, and
I'm just so ecstatic that you came on, man. Like, really, I really am ecstatic.
I'm ecstatic. Okay. I'm ecstatic that Dave caught us a unicorn. we've been looking for you for a while, and you do exist. So, hooray!
Yeah. Well, you know, let me tell you a little bit about myself as from my law enforcement background, and then we can kind of go from there. But I have a bachelor's degree in criminal justice from Charleston Southern University, and I was a former member of the United States Coast Guard, a reservist. With them for 6 years, and I was a police officer with the city of North Charleston from 2002 until 2007. North Charleston was ranked the 8th most dangerous city at the time. You know, and our main mission of our 300-man police force was get guns and drugs off the streets. And as a believer in the drug war, I patrolled drug-plagued neighborhoods for 4 years. I was a detective for 2 years. I made hundreds of arrests, many of them drug-related, assisted in drug warrant SWAT raids, drug street sweeps, and drug-related murder investigations. After 6 years, my career was cut short. I was hit by a pickup truck directing traffic at a car accident, so I traded my badge in for a permanent limp. So that's how I got out of law enforcement.
Did this guy get prosecuted in any way?
No.
Oh, okay. So it was like a...
Yeah, no, it was just an accident. Yeah. Okay. He was just rubbernecking and he just kind of turned and right into me. So lucky it didn't run over me, but did break my leg and my ankle. Ooh. And that never did.
Get killed there. That's
quite
healed.
Yeah, didn't heal back right. So, but today, I continue to serve my community as a member of LEAP. And LEAP stands for Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. And their Twitter handle is Cops Say Legalize. So I know that sounds kind of weird. You're talking about unicorns. But we believe that all drugs, should be legalized. And so that way you can regulate them and actually make our streets safer. I'm not alone. We've got about 100,000 members and supporters worldwide in 120 countries. And this guy's from patrol cops like me all the way up DEA, FBI agents, former police chiefs, prosecutors.
DEA?
Yep.
Hey, I want my job to not exist anymore.
But, yeah, our members believe that the war on drugs has not only failed but worse. It has become a self-perpetuating, constantly expanding policy disaster. And so that's what
I contend right now that the biggest disconnect between the American people and the police in their area has been the drug war. It's turned police into basically an armed military that has any reason that they can kick your door in now. And people don't trust the police anymore because of that. Not that, you know, there's always people that have never trust police, but in a large majority, I guarantee you that if you was to look at police trust in the 1960s before the drug war, and then you look at police police trust in the last 15 years, I guarantee you it would be drastically different.
It is. I would say that our drug enforcement is really about 80% of the problems with law enforcement. If you ended violent prohibition enforcement, you would end about 80% of the problems that we have with law enforcement and probably about that much crime as well.
Well, yeah. I mean, if I say eating popsicles on the sidewalk is a crime, you know, it's people are going to still do it.
Yeah. You're talking about a militarized police state. We have the world's largest prison population here in the United States. We're supposed to be, the shining city on the hill and the freest country in the world. And the United States has 5% of the world's population and 25% of the world's prison population. We have 2.2 million people currently in jail or prison right now, 7 million under some type of correctional control. So not only do we have the highest percentage of our population in prison, but we have the highest number of people in prison total than any other country in the world. So the United States has close to 800 per 100,000 residents in jail or prison. Just for example, Russia has about 550. China is a little bit less than that. The average in Europe is about 130 people in some jail or prison per 100,000 members of their population. So, you know, we are really a Soviet era gulag prison numbers.
Stalin is green with envy. Stalin would be jealous.
East Germany police state, I mean, that's the type of numbers that we have. And so to say that, that we're not in a police state, you can't deny that number.
Well, yeah, and if you listen to Tom Wood's show the other day, he was talking about the murder rate per police officers in the United States is higher than anything in the entire world. Per 100,000 police officers, they kill more people than any other group in the world, even like the Congo child soldiers. Like they kill more people than that. Like that is something has to change. I think it is changing, but you have all these fascistic, deep, like a dug in like a tick interests, private police or private prisons, the police guard unions, the DEAs, the judges, the extra cops you're going to have on certain, like, think about a regular department. How many cops are they going to lose if they're no longer enforcing drugs? Well, the argument now they're using is, what do you want? All these cops to just be starving out on the street and not be able to feed their family? Yes! If it means people don't get put in jail, yes. For doing harm to themselves, yes. I don't want that cop to be employed.
Right. So in our prison population in state jails and county jails, about 24% are directly drug-related incarcerations. In a federal prison, it's even worse. It's close to 50% are direct. And I would assert that really the numbers are much higher when you talk about just drug-related type crimes that people go to prison for. It's all about it's all prohibition enforcement related, not the drug itself. The black markets creates all the violence. The criminalization, and when you give people criminal records, that basically forces them into criminal activities and excludes them from normal productive jobs.
Well, sure. Yeah. That's what happens when you continually try to legislate morality and continue to make more and more things illegal. That, you know, as Dave said, you know, you're not doing, for the most part, you're not doing harm to anybody else other than yourself. At least while ingesting them, for the most part. I mean, obviously, if somebody gets whacked out of their gourd on something and then gets behind the wheel of a car and kills somebody, that's a different story. But that happens much more with alcohol, which, of course, is perfectly legal.
Doctor, my back's hurting. Give me a 20 script of Xanax, and then I go drive and kill somebody. The argument is moot.
I understand that. That's what I was saying. It's not really a valid argument, but that's what happens because they just... People get it in their head that certain things are quote-unquote bad, and that they don't want them around. They don't want people they know having them around, so they just want them taken away from everybody. You know, one thing I would say, just to push back on a little something you said, Raeford, just a little while ago about the black markets and violence. The markets don't create the violence. The state actually creates the violence by making the markets necessary. Because the market, I mean, the term black market always annoys me, and I'm not saying anything against you for saying it, because most people use it, but it's a term that in order to make people think that it's a bad thing, but it's just really all it is voluntary exchange between consenting adults, and you know,
yeah,
and just
some you're
people
right.
don't like what's passed.
It's untaxed. Yeah. It's an untaxed transaction, is what it is. That's a black market. So like, If I was to get like 10 cartons of cigarettes and then go sell them untaxed.
No, I get it. I was just saying for me personally, I don't like the term because of the negative connotation, the reason it was used. You know, the same reason, getting back to the drug war that we're talking about, the same reason, you know, I prefer the term cannabis over marijuana, because marijuana is just, was a mostly, you know, for the most part, a made up term that was just thrown out there.
It's literally a weed from Mexico.
Yes, that's the literal translation of it. It had nothing to do with the cannabis plant. It was just used, you know, through the yellow journalism of people like William Randolph Hearst in order to demonize it. And then black markets, the same thing. They're called black markets, so people think they're bad, they're evil. You don't want to, you know, you don't want to be involved in the black market. It's dangerous. Well, again, it's dangerous because the state makes it dangerous by forcing people into these avenues, so they don't have to deal with the ridiculous regulations, the onerous taxes, all the BS that comes with the state interfering in the market itself. Because if the state wasn't interfering, the black market would be the market that most of us would prefer to use.
Right.
I agree with everything, you know, everything else you're saying. That's just a little bone of contention for me, but it was, I wasn't really directing at you. I'm just clarifying.
Yeah. Is underground market better?
Yeah. No, it's fine. Like I said, people use it. I'm not going to chastise people for using it. I was just saying that for me, it's a little annoying.
Jeremy likes to chastise people. So.
Yes, I do.
the other day, a lady, we were discussing the drug war, and she said, well, if we legalize drugs, what message are we sending to our kids? And I asked her, I said, so are you wanting the government to raise your kids? Because that's what it sounds like to me. And she kind of like stopped and stuttered in her tracks. And she was like, well, no, but you understand. I'm like, no, I don't understand what you're saying, because you just said, what kind of message are we be sending if we get the government out of what people can and can't put in their body? We're sending a message that, hey, I don't really want to control my neighbor.
Yeah.
And exactly. That violence is bad. That's the message that we're sending.
Yes, and I would say back to her that, you know, by supporting prohibition, you're supporting use of violence against other people.
Yes.
For personal choices that they make, and that's a terrible message to send to children, and is part of the reason why we have such a violent world. You know, when I was a police officer, you know, I believed in it. Hey, drugs are bad, and then went out on the street and saw it. There is a real nexus between illegal drugs and a lot of crime and murders and assaults and drive-by shootings and all of this. But, and so you believe it and you're like, yeah, okay, yeah, this is, you know, this is terrible. You wouldn't want to live in some of these neighborhoods. They, you know, it was terrible. So you're like, we've got to get the drugs. If we get the drugs off the street and get the drug dealers off the street, then, you know, the crime will go away. And if we don't, you know, hold that line, they'll just take over the whole neighborhoods. And so that's when you're there and you see that, it makes sense. But if you don't step back and say, hey, it's the actual laws in the creation of the prohibition that sets it all up and creates and what I call fosters the entire environment that it artificially creates the profit motive, and then it also excludes proper dispute resolution. This is why you have violence that's associated with the drugs. It's not the drugs. People are excluded from normal dispute resolution mechanisms.
I know what you're talking about.
So if we have Budweiser and Miller beer distributors, and you know their substances, you know, alcohol is dangerous and makes you violent, but yet somehow those guys are able to drive their trucks and go to the same convenience store and stack their goods right next to each other and never get in a fight. They never have problems with the convenience stores. They front product to them, give it to them, and say, hey, you know, we'll come pick up the check after, you know, after it sells. And yet they don't have problems with convenience stores because they can write contracts, have bank accounts and checks and receipts. And if somebody doesn't pay, they can take them to court. But you have all of that is banned from you when you use cannabis instead of whiskey. Mm-hmm. It's the same way. And so
that alcohol was ranked the number one dangerous drug in the entire world.
Right. But all of that street violence and neighborhood violence is all from that. So if you are selling, if you're selling marijuana and you front product to somebody and they don't pay, what do? You have to go directly to violence. You have to intimidate them. And then if that doesn't work, you've got to use violence. If you don't, you're out of business immediately. And so that actually self-selects for people that will be violent. That's why we see the drug gangs down in Mexico are so violent. It's because it actually selects. And it was the same with alcohol prohibition and Al Capone. That's how he became the top guy, was because he was willing to use the most violence. And then the artificial profit motive pays for the violence. Violence is the most expensive way to resolve disputes. Mm-hmm. And so if there's a I'll tell you about the profit motive and profit margin. In Mexico, for methamphetamine, the raw material cost is about 28 cents a gram. That's their basic raw material cost. And so methamphetamine, once it's produced and shipped in the United States and sold, is what, $80 a gram? So that's a...
Depends on where you get
a, it. Right. That's a huge market. Gold is $40 a gram. So,
yeah, that's much more valuable. Yeah, you know,
the harder something is to get,
it's created artificially.
The thing is government, people that want government to fix a problem, especially a vice or what they consider a moral hazard, they don't understand that no matter what, the laws of supply and demand always reign supreme. That's why I tell every communist that ever says anything to me, I say, it doesn't. You can have the most strict communist government in the entire world, and the rules of law, the rule of supply and demand will still reign supreme. Look at Russia. 80%, it's in some places of their area, was black market. That's the only way they propped up their area.
Right. What changes drug use and abuse is education and information. That's what changes the rates, and even if that is what your goal, I think your goal should be harm reduction if there's any social policy.
And you think anybody sticking a heroin needle in their arm, you think anybody at that point in their life is a well-adjusted person?
Right. So, that you know, there's problems and issues that bring people to that place. And my answer would be to that, criminalization and incarceration does not help, however they got there. That is a terrible idea. It's horribly costly. Oh, yeah, and it destroys liberty.
Nixon's report even said it before they started the war on drugs. Yeah, so treatment's probably a better way, but, you know, we have all these people giving money to our campaign so they can start up private prisons and unions. And it's just a big boondoggle that involves a lot of people dying. And that's the tragedy of the whole thing. Even if you're not a drug user, you're sitting on the sidelines here, and you're sitting here going, all these people are dying for what? To prop up government organizations and to keep dealers and suppliers making outrageous amounts of money?
Yeah, you know, they're making money. How much they are on the street level, you know, you know, at the retail end, not so much, you know.
No.
You know, the kids that I was dealing with were, you know, they weren't making enough to get out of the hood, that's for sure.
I
was just going to say, I think of a cartoon of you know, aliens that come here and then they come out of their spaceship, and then you see police officers pointing guns at, you know, plants. And they're like, you guys are retarded. What the hell are you doing? And that's basically what it is, you know. It's like, it's not they call it a war on drugs, but it's really a war on people, right? People using the drugs, you know, the drugs don't go to jail, the people go to jail, right? The drugs go somewhere else, right? Maybe they go to the Mexican drug cartels anyway, once they confiscate it. But yeah, it's you know, it's like Lysander Spooner, you know, says it's, you know, there's a big difference between a vice and a crime. Right, big difference, and that's
and
what.
And there's a difference with how you handle it and treat it when it's someone else. It's a vice. Well, they're not using. They may be causing harm, but they're not using violence. And so, non-aggression principle means you can never initiate violence. You can. It's only use physical force and self-defense. And when a police officer arrests someone for nonviolent consensual activity between adults or themselves, then it's the police officer that's initiating that violence. And that is morally wrong. It's against natural law or cosmic karma or ethics or whatever you want to call it. And I felt that. And I didn't, you know, I believed in it. Drugs are bad, man. Let's lock these guys up. Yeah, right on. But, you know, when I would arrest these guys and some of them were not lovable individuals, I can guarantee it. But it still, you know, it didn't feel quite right. Like something was off.
Can you go into your history of how you came to volunteerism? I know you talked about your police officer, you know, time, but can you how were you introduced to volunteerism? What influenced you?
Yeah, well, you know, as a police, and so I didn't feel right with the drug enforcement, and didn't quite understand why, but I was like, you know, this is not right. These guys were not, you know, I learned quickly that we weren't really making a difference and that we actually were aggravating the neighborhood and causing animosity when we would get tough or try to clamp down. And I felt that it wasn't quite right what we were doing. So when I had a chance to get off the street, I went into we did juvenile crimes and sexual assaults and child abuse. And so I intentionally got away from, you know, the drug arrests and would try to, you know, hey, let me go into a unit where we can actually, you know, have some real crime and instead of this non-crime drug war. And so that's how I kind of absolved myself from it. But then I, you know, when I got hurt and got out of the police department and, you know, just had questions. A basic question for a police officer is, you know, like a use of force continuum. When is it okay to use force? You know, and so what questions do you ask yourself when you're going to use force as a police officer? What guidelines? Well, you look at your policy. You look at state law. You know, am I lawfully present where I'm at? You know, what does my police department policy say? What does the federal court say? What's the Supreme Court? What's the Constitution? What all, you know, am I legally justified? But you've got to go, that still didn't answer my question. There's still one step further you got to go. And that's, is it morally justified? And actually, that's the very first question you ask yourself, is what I'm doing is morally justified? And that, and so, yeah, after I was got out of law enforcement, that's what I started searching for, you know, and found guys like Ron Paul and Lew Rockwell. And then, there's this guy named Murray Rothbard and this non-aggression
nice.
Principle.
Nice.
And then it all opened up and the whole, yeah, the non-aggression principle. It is never okay to initiate violence against another person, period. And oh, okay, I see. And now, so if that, you know, but that takes forever to understand that. It took me about 2 years. And that's very difficult because I had to admit that, yes, everything I had been taught, all the way up through college, everything my parents and my people that I trusted, my sergeants and everybody that I looked up to, has been wrong, and that my actions were wrong, and I actually caused harm to other people because of it. Now, then that was, and what even makes it even worse is I was not malevolent. I thought what I was doing was right, and when you know that is very hard to get yourself, your conscience to wrap around and to admit.
So here's my next burning question for you. Do you believe there's such a thing as a good cop?
Well, most 95% of cops have good intentions, and that is the truth. This whole thing about these bad cops, and if we just get them out, you know, that's not true. It's the cops like me with good intentions that enforce bad laws and immoral and unjust laws that causes the most harm to society. So, you know, you have that right there. You know, my answer would be, well, all cops are paid by taxes, which is money that's taken by theft. So, you know, however, whatever good job they're doing, they're getting paid with stolen money. So there's that. Cops do real jobs, though. We have real crime, and that's part of what makes it difficult as well, is you do really good work, and that even in any kind of libertarian, voluntarist world, you would have professional security, dispute resolution, investigative people that would probably wear uniforms and badges and everything and look just the same.
Dave's Arbitration Services, look it up.
Right. And that would be part of what, you know, and so that gets mixed up with what law enforcement officers do. And, that, you know, there was times when I had, real crime and put my life in jeopardy, to help others.
Well, I think the story that is told to people that want to be cops is drastically different than when you actually become a cop and see it for what it is. Because I know a few cops around town, and they have things to say about their job that, you know, it kind of shows that not everybody's heart is 100% into this whole rah-rah, let's go get the bad guy thing. It's like half my job is BS revenue generation.
It can be. You know, yeah, I didn't go into traffic either because, man, I didn't want to go writing tickets all the time, for stuff like that. That wasn't my thing. And if you like traffic, that's what you're going to do. You choose your rate, choose your fate, you know, in a lot of ways with some of those things. But no, they generally do want to do well. You do get paid, and it's a pretty good gig, and you have a lot of excitement, and which is nice. But yeah, you know, I had a good opportunity when I was in Detective Division. I would go through all of the incident reports every day and put them to the proper that required a further investigation and send them to their appropriate unit. And really about 70% of the reports there were really unnecessary and were just – I don't think – in a lot of ways law enforcement, it's a free – it's like socialized – you know, dispute resolution and services.
Yep.
And so people use it because, well, it's free. And so, you know, they have any little problem free with their neighbors that and we're taught, hey, if you have a problem, call 911, right? I mean, from a small kid. So that's what people do. People make no effort to resolve their disputes with their neighbors or even family members or whatever. They just call the cops and have them do it and have no skin in it. And then so people can actually use law enforcement as well as in a very passive-aggressive manner.
I haven't really looked at it as like a socialized, it's a product that people want. I've looked at it that way, but I haven't looked at it as a socialized product that people want and how people abuse social, because like, you look, go to, I got a few friends that live in Canada. Oh, I stubbed my toe. I'm going to the emergency room.
Well, that's the same. That's the same way with law enforcement. Yeah. I knew families' names and their whole history within, a year or two on the street. I would know everything about particular families, and that's insane. That's how much contact I had with these people. Over a lot of it was BS and just total, drama. And when's the last time any of y'all had, called the police or, a normal person has very little contact with a law enforcement.
The last time I called the police, I was driving on the interstate and someone was in front of me. It was really late and they just started swerving and then rolled off into the thing. And then I dialed 911. I said, I think some drunk just wrecked. I'm at this mile marker and that. I said, I can't wait here for it, but my name is David. And I said, if somebody ain't in this ditch dead, call me back for filing a false report. But I'm on my way. I can't stop.
Right.
And that happened. That was about 5-6 years ago. That's the last time I called the police. I mean, I have no need for. I don't need their services.
Well, right.
Most people. Well, I think what Raeford was saying before. A lot of people don't actually need them. It's just a reflex because, like you said, they're we're all taught this. You have a problem. The police. It's all part of the indoctrination process that starts as a kid. You go to school and on career day, police officers are brought in and you're taught that this is just the next level of authority that you now have to respect when you get out of school, because it starts with your parents, and a lot of parents initiate force or coerce their children into things without realizing it, just because that's the way they were brought up. And then, they're the authority. You hear so many parents all the time with the phrase, because I said so, or anything like that. Like, not explaining things to a kid, just I'm the authority, or the simple thing of teaching them lies from an early age that later become a contradiction. It's like, oh, don't lie, but it's okay for mommy and daddy to tell you that things exist that don't, and then you have to find out later on. And then they pass you off to the children, to the school teachers, and the school teacher is the next line, where it's, this is now the authority. You have to listen to the teacher. You have to listen to the principal. And then they invite cops in for career day and say, okay, this is Mr. Police Officer. Yeah. This is going to be, if you're ever in danger, you call him and you have to listen to him because he's now the authority, and it just gets passed up the line. So we're all bombarded with that from a young
age. That's hard to break. Hey, Danella, you were saying what else brought me to, libertarian voluntarianism. I was injured. I had a lot of arthritis, that's still to this day in my leg, and two other things that really got me and brought me over was changing my diet. And I went to like a paleo style diet. I was terribly out of shape, and traditional nutrition. Hey, eat lots of veggies and fruits and veggies and 6 meals a day, and exercise a little bit, and take lots of anti-inflammatory medications and this and that, and I did the total opposite. I went to 1 meal a day and high protein and fat and
yeah, that's been my problem.
And like, exercising,
I can go all morning, and I can eat 1 meal a day and be fine, as long as it's a really big meal. And
so I did opposite with that, and you start looking into, had some family members that suffered with some disease and stuff, and you realize that, what the doctors and traditional medications, how much harm they cause, and you kind of lift your eyes.
So blink twice if you've used marijuana for that arthritis.
Well, no, I'll tell you that
Jeremy's over there blinking like,
oh,
yeah, like,
oh, you weren't talking to me, I'm sorry.
Well, I did use marijuana in high school and stuff, and so this is a bit hypocritical to go and arrest
I have not met one police officer that's like, yeah, marijuana should be illegal.
No. They all say that. The other drugs I've done is, I've done cocaine and heroin.
Well, I mean, who hasn't?
But no. Actually, the cocaine was Ritalin that
I'm
my
sure
parents
DeMello
gave
hasn't.
Me. when I was
not cocaine.
Grade.
I mean,
I'm eccentric enough, so.
Yeah, and
I did cocaine once, and it will never happen again to me. It's not for me. And that's the big thing about drugs, and that's what I try to tell people is like. Doug Benson, the guy who's like always like super high or whatever, he does a thing on his comedy specials. He'll come out and he'll say, "Who here has smoked weed?" And like the whole crowd raised their hand, right? And then it's like, he'll say, "Who here doesn't smoke weed but they've tried it?" And like like four or five people raise their hand, and he'll be like, "Why?" And like every one of them is like, "It's just not for me." So it's like, why not let people choose what's right for their body? There's people that have been using heroin or some kind of opium or opiate for 60 years and they're fine. I mean, they've got some damage, but they're fine.
Well, I do understand. The heroin I took, that was morphine. I took that when I was in the hospital and they sent me home with oxycodone.
I like the
morphine. Oxycodone was horrible, and that stuff, was
I had
a terrible reaction.
I had four friends die off of that stuff.
With that stuff, that was the worst thing I have ever taken in my life. I drink occasionally, and that's all I do now. There's options. I have real pain, and so I understand people now that have chronic pain and how devastating that can be. And so to take any options away from someone just because of your puritanical views is just ridiculous, and just it's not humane or any type of Christian principle or anything to treat someone like
so
that.
Ridiculous.
I was just going to agree with you. I was going to say absolutely, because I think we might have discussed this a little bit last week, or maybe it was the week before, where I said it's literally insane that there's legislation in certain states to finally, quote-unquote, allow people to use certain things when they have been, declared terminal already. And it's like, well, no, now you still have to get permission to try other drugs that may alleviate your pain.
It's because it's a little secret. You're the state's property.
Well, that's not really a secret, but
okay, all right.
But no, you're right though. It is. It's ridiculous that it's kept from people. And as Dave was saying, it's just why would you keep people from because there are those people that'll use this stuff and it won't affect them, or it won't affect them. It won't affect others negatively, and they can use it their entire lives. Why should they be stopped from being able to do so when just because somebody else may not be able to handle it and may take a large dose and may do stupid things? Like it's the same thing as anything else. It's punishing the collective instead of the individual, or trying to punish the product instead of the individual, just like with the gun battle.
Well, I've talked to some physicians, who advocate, yes, these drugs are terrible and they must be illegal. Because they cause, we've done MRI scans, and here's the damage to the brain that they do. But you ask that same doctor, so would you prescribe to a person that's actually addicted, which is a small percentage of users, a person that's actually addicted, would you, as a treatment plan, lock them in a cage with actual criminals and leave them there for 6 months or a year and then let them out? And would that be an appropriate medical treatment? I say, of course not. Nobody would condone that. But yet that's what you're advocating law enforcement do on your behalf.
They don't see the contradictions, man.
And they go, that's your thing.
We'll just agree to disagree.
Yes. Yeah. So that makes no sense whatsoever. And would a doctor lock up people that are asymptomatic and of a totally another patient or just a stranger walking down the street and go and arrest them and lock them in a cage, and that's somehow going to help their patient? That's ridiculous. I mean, it's just...
So did you ever let anybody go? Like, you caught them red-handed and you're just like, hey, here's your lucky day.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, we did. But, you know, honestly, this is more feel bad, but it's also just kind of practical purposes. We've already had enough paperwork for the day, you know.
Oh, my God.
So, you know, you're like, hey, we're trying to get out of here early, or, you know, at least on, we're already going to be late.
I'm hungry. I got to.
Yeah. You know, we're already late. So, you know, get out of here, kid.
That'll change someone's life better than locking them up. It'll scare them more than that.
Yeah, you know, sometimes our sergeant would say, look, don't arrest anybody today, you know, unless they're, what was the saying, unless they're running through a daycare, you know, with a bloody hatchet, you know, or something. Otherwise, just let it ride.
So did you ever see any cops, like, plant evidence or anything?
No, I did not. You know, that's the thing, never... You know, I never saw anything just horribly immoral or real vicious or anything like that. You know, nothing. Everybody had a lot of integrity. Did police officers make a lot of mistakes and from their personal lives? Oh yeah, you bet. You know, but no, nothing. You know, horrible. You know, I hear about all of this, and we just didn't see much of that. Like I said, it's the good, well-intentioned officers that are following laws that cause the most of the harm.
Maybe
you know, I didn't have to, like, steal from somebody or something. I'll tell you how I could screw somebody over: tow their car. Yeah, okay. You arrest somebody for a drug charge or a drug paraphernalia charge on the side of the road, and you tow their car. And, man, that screws them over so bad because now they're out of vehicle. It's up at an impound lot getting fees charged. And then they have to go around and find paperwork saying they're the registered owner, and that can be difficult to do. And then go down to the police department and get a release and then, you know, go up to the – and they probably won't have some paperwork quite right. And then they'll have to go, you know, up to the tow lot and pay all of that and get the car out. And I mean, the people would probably rather me give them a beat down and let them go than you know, to do something like that. But yeah, it's called the process is the punishment. I really didn't care if I got convictions or anything, but if you arrest someone, charge them and force them to go through, you know, this absolute crucible of a legal system, man, that is just punishment enough. And so you pull the people away, and people that are addicted or have some type of issue, you pull them away, they're going to lose their job. Like I said, they'll probably lose their transportation, you know, and they're going to be away from their family and their children. You're going to force them to have to go to court for months, you know, back and forth to hearing and probation officers and this and that, and pay all these fees and pay a bail bondsman. And so any positive, they're going to lose their job. Any positive social interactions that these people have, you just broke it all. And So not only did I lock them up, but I locked them in even tighter to the cycle of abuse, drug abuse and crime. I just, you know, kicked them right on down. And that's what people with drug abuse problems, so many don't. They're just casual users. And so I've taken them from fairly stable, who just have a habit that's, you know, they enjoy something other than alcohol or along with alcohol, and just straight out criminalized them and just, you know, broke them from being productive members of society. And now they're this underclass criminal element that we've just created, you know, millions of individuals. You know, like I said, you know, 2 million a year. Go ahead.
No, sorry. I was just going to say, being a voluntarist, former police officer, I assume that you get into conversation with people and they say, so you're against the police, so what do you want? Just, like, you know, no laws, no order, just chaos? Like, do you get that a lot, being a former police officer and a volunteer?
Yeah, what I would say is, you know, let's get law enforcement from... Just stop them from the harm that they're causing. Just stop that. And then we'll talk. You know,
I think a lot of,
and then we can go together, and everybody can have, you know, their opinion and idea, and see what you know, our world should look like.
I agree, and I think a lot of anarchists, of voluntarists, whatever, they don't take a pragmatic approach to this situation. They take the moral approach to it. You know, cops are paid for by theft. They should not be there. We all know that, but it's not a light switch. We can't turn it off tomorrow. Okay, it's not going to happen. I don't care. I mean, unless a miracle, you know, somebody who can grant wishes or something.
Right.
So we have to take a pragmatic approach to this, and, you know, I've publicly stated the only way I'm voting is to stop the war on drugs, stop any step in that. Because if you got cops and distilled down to, and perfectly put them in a place to prevent real crimes, which is all crime is either theft, destruction, or intimidation, or not intimidation, but
force, fraud, or coercion.
Well, on property, and that is it.
Right.
Because you own yourself.
Or your human body is your property.
Yeah, you're, yeah. So everything is property. So
yes.
So if we got cops doing just that, that would alleviate a lot of the state's problem that is currently growing. And I'm not saying I want that to happen. I want the state to be in the worst position possible. But I don't think that the problem with police officers that is currently, you know, in America right now, it's going to be fixed overnight. It's just not.
No. And so I agree with what you're saying. Yeah, I think the drug war, you know, as far as law enforcement is concerned, is about, like I said, 80% of the problem. What I want to see is I want to change people's minds and their hearts. And that's there's, you know, we have, you know, hundreds of thousands of police officers, and I want them to change how they think for themselves, and to say, look, I need to, you know, go and sin no more and stop causing harm to others with my actions. And so we have this great number of people that are misguided in law enforcement, and so that's, you know, it's a fertile ground for a lot of people to change their hearts and their minds, and that's what I want to do.
The police officers have no moneyed right now. They have no moneyed investment into solving murders, solving thefts, solving break-ins, etc. But they have a lot of moneyed interest in locking up a few dudes for smoking weed. A lot.
Well, there is, you know, it is certainly policing for profit. You're talking about, you know, we have a homicide
clear rate
of like 50% nationwide. It's
Baltimore,
crazy.
It's like 12%.
Right, and a lot of that is the drug war. People will not cooperate because, you know, they'll go to jail. Well, you were involved in drugs, when really they were, you know, most of them were self-defense.
Drug dealer will kill them.
Or somebody will kill them.
Oh,
yes.
Hey, you talk to the police officers, guess what? You're going to be in some bando fucking face down in a pool of blood.
Right. So, see, all of that would stop if you end the prohibition enforcement. You know, all of that would go away, and the murder rates and everything. It would take time, but they would go way down. Look.
Wow. I don't know.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I think, at least from my view, the only way that could occur, and the slow rate and the drop that you're describing, would be if it was everything across the board.
Yes.
Okay, good.
Cannabis
wouldn't do that.
No, if you just legalize marijuana, you know, that would help. And
83% of the DEA's budget is for marijuana.
No, I get that.
83. But you cannot. If you lose 83% of your business, you go bankrupt.
No, not when you're the government. Because
obviously,
government. Well, because what would happen is if it's just, I mean, and I would at some point, I would like to get into the legalization versus the decriminalization conversation if we have time. But if you just legalize or decriminalize cannabis right now, the markets you know, the aforementioned black markets would just shift to the other products instead, and you would still end up with the violence. You would still end up with the DEA and everybody else pouring their money into these things because they'd be like, okay, this is the problem now, and we're going to focus all our attention on this. So it's if it's an across the board thing, and I read what you were saying wrong. So if we're in agreement with that, I guess that if you did the sweeping thing where you either legalized or decriminalized everything, then yes, then you would start to see a steady decline. And that, you know, but on the other hand, but I don't see that occurring.
The argument for marijuana legalization carries to all other drugs at its core.
From a logical and moral standpoint, which is not a good argument in statist land, man.
Well, the problem is the marijuana is not going to become legal in this country unless the money is stronger than the money to keep it legal.
I disagree with that. The government and the controls, they only operate with people's consent. And people consent to be enslaved, basically. And so if they clamp down too hard, people, it's the whole Star Wars thing, Tarkin, you know. The more you tighten your grip, the more star systems slip through your fingers. It's the same thing. So let me try to explain marijuana legalization, all drug legalization, and decriminalization, and what you'll see the difference. Marijuana legalization would be great because you have about 600,000 people a year that are arrested for it. 66%, two-thirds of legal drug users are people that use marijuana alone. So if you legalize marijuana, all of a sudden you cut the legal drug users rate in the United States by two-thirds, and you get all of those people out from underneath our criminalization incarceration system, which is wonderful. And so that's a great thing. Now, you still have the other drugs, and when we go to straight legalization, you know, that's where you would get the serious drop in your crime rates, and you would get the crime issues that we have in other countries like Mexico and Central America. All of that would start to go away. When you have decriminalization does help with those drugs because, again, people that are actually addicts can get real help, and that's a positive, and they're not incarcerated. And then we don't have this, you know, that takes away, like I said, 24% of state prisons. That's a lot of people that are not harmed by the prohibition. And that's a good thing. You still have the gangs and the cartels and the crime and the smuggling and everything else that will go along. But there were less people harmed with the decriminalization. But, the best world is the legalization all the way. And that gives communities the ability to regulate, the drugs in their own communities. Right now, they're forbidden from doing that.
I'm just gonna give a little quick story. I was talking to my mother, who's an outright democratic socialist, more socialist, and I was talking about the case in Portugal, 2002. They decriminalized cannabis, and then
everything,
the rates, was it everything?
They decriminalized. It's a little different.
Decriminalized. Yeah, and so that's what I said, and the rate of addiction and went down as people were able to seek therapy and get help and treatment and that kind of for their addiction problem, and then my mother comes out and says, "Aha, you support the state, you want it to be regulated."
Yeah,
and I'm like, wait a minute, what? I didn't say that.
Well, that's what I was gonna say, because that for me, I get what you're saying, and as far as like in a numbers game, it would probably, I guess theoretically, make things maybe safer or quicker with the legalization. But with legalization means that government, the state, can still regulate it. That's right. Why I prefer the decriminalization, where yes, those cartels and gangs that you're describing could still be there, but if more people are able to produce it, sell it on their own, like if I could do it in my backyard, then turn it, like there's less need for that.
Let me ask a question.
Well, hold on a second. I just want to say this, because the one thing that I see that if the USFG were to come down and say, okay, we're gonna, you know, override the states like we normally do, and legalize everything, and so that way it can be regulated, which means then therefore it can be taxed. The markets and the cartels are still going to exist in almost full force. Like, they'll take a hit initially, but you'll see the same thing that is happening in Colorado. Yes, Colorado is pulling in a crap ton of tax money, but the black market is still flourishing there because there's people who don't want to pay the 25 to 30% tax rate on this stuff when they can go down to their friend and get it cheaper and often get just as good, if not better, stuff. So by legalizing it, the state still keeps a stranglehold, and it will reverse engineer what we were talking about before with the slow, you know, if you do it where the rates will drop, they will actually slowly start to increase again because enough people will get fed up with dealing with the regulations, dealing with the state, and say, well, no, I'd just rather go back to the open market again, whoever that is. Like I said, that's just my perspective.
Yeah,
I prefer
agree.
The decriminalization.
And as a member of law enforcement against prohibition, you know, their goal is legalization and regulation with a focus on harm reduction. You know, we have lots of people, and they have all these different opinions about what level of regulation. Now, me as a voluntarist, I would say, here's what I would say. Absolutely, drugs need to be regulated. And the more powerful drugs like heroin and everything need a lot of regulation. It's so important, in fact, that we should not have the government anywhere near it. And that individuals
that is a good
and business and local communities can regulate where
yes.
and under what conditions they will sell, and they can do it.
Well, not
with,
even the local communities, the person themselves.
Your local stores and all, you know, if they put, you know, heroin, you know, in the candy rack, you're probably not going to go to that store. You know, those guys are crazy, and they kill a couple of kids, and people ain't going to go there.
I don't even want to be anywhere near heroin.
So, right. But, you know, some stores, my grocery store, I go down the aisle with it with my kids, and we get on, you know, the soda aisle. There's soda on one side and beer and wine on the other. My kids have never accidentally grabbed a wine bottle and chugged it and poisoned themselves or something.
And soda kills so many people.
Yeah, that's never
happened.
Tylenol and aspirin are
so my question on the decriminalization versus legalization is, okay, legalization, they say, okay, it's legalized, you can sell it tax regulated, whatever, all right? On the decriminalization, could I open up a store and sell weed?
Well, see, no, you couldn't. What it would be is
okay,
just
so then
we
you're
don't
killing
we just
a ton of people's livelihoods. You're
well,
still,
you would,
you're
you
still
would
still
do it underground,
it
they would just never arrest you for it. Is supposed to be the deal. And see how that
every
works.
Every decriminalization comes with a .. but so, right. Like, in Mexico just now, they just decriminalized all small amounts of any drug. So, if you got an 8-ball of coke on you, you're not going to jail. But if you have so much coke, you're going to jail. So, that still keeps the Mexico government drug enforcement boondoggle going, and that still keeps putting people in jail, and people are still going to be killing because...
Well, let me give you an idea of some numbers. Here in South Carolina, for marijuana, we arrest approximately 18,000 people a year for marijuana offenses. 16,000 of those are possession, just simple possession arrest. So if you decriminalize, that 16,000 people are not arrested.
You're left with the 2,000. I'm not saying that if we can't get legal, then we should just say fuck it and keep the status quo. Any steps towards more freedom, I'm for.
Yes.
But the question I've got at the core is, wouldn't legalization make more sense? And I know when something's legalized, there's still black markets. I mean, look at cigarettes, look at tobacco.
Well, Jeremy, you were talking about words earlier and using the words black market, and you know, I almost hate the word legalization, and I would turn it around and say, I don't really want to legalize. I want to end violent. I want to abolish. There's your word. Abolish violent, immoral, unjustified prohibition enforcement. I want to end violent prohibition enforcement. That's what I want to. That's what I want. Who would disagree with that?
The state to go away. The whole state.
So that the legalization puts in people's mind that they have to take some affirmative step to do so, and that's not true. I want to end your affirmative thing that you're doing is violent government sponsored prohibition enforcement, and I just want you to stop that.
It is terrorism. It literally is terrorism.
End your participation, and for individuals that are not in law enforcement, for you to end your support. So people that are citizens, I want them to say, you know what, this drug war does not work, and it's immoral and unconstitutional, and I no longer support prohibition enforcement.
No, that does make sense, and I think maybe just to clarify my position a little bit, I think of it in terms of legalization means the state still has the ability to take control in some sense.
They will.
But what do you know?
We'll end up with Eric Garner. Choked out in New York for tax cigarettes.
I know. That's right. That was right in my backyard.
We'll have the same stuff. Yeah.
Well, Colorado, it's kind of like decriminalized / legalized, right?
No, it's legalized, but
you can still grow your own.
Yes,
you can for seven. I think 7 ounces of possession. Or is that? What was that raid in California? See where the police officers did that horrible that SWAT raid.
They were eating the edibles and pushed the lady in the wheelchair and like out the mirror, made fun of her. That's
bars and everything.
Yeah,
and see that's because that business. There's something about contracts, and you know, they're saying like $500,000 fees, $500,000 worth of fees, to operate their business in the city limits, that type of thing.
Yeah.
And so you're going to get all those just insane, extortive type conditions. How much of that is the difference? You know, I don't know.
Well, yeah, I was just to finish what I was saying before, though, which kind of goes back to that, is for the because these things can happen with legalization, and when I say I prefer decriminalization because I don't want the government regulating it, I mean, I think we've discussed this in different situations before, but it doesn't mean that I don't want any regulation. Like you were saying before, Raeford, about how, you know, the communities could do it themselves. I'm thinking more along the lines of, yeah, those heavier type of drugs or, you know, whatever anything like that. If you want to be smart and you want to be safe, you're going to want to make sure they're okay. But getting the state out of the regulation game doesn't mean that I or people that espouse the same ideas that I do want no regulation. We just don't want the state regulating it.
Right.
Because the market process is what causes regulation. It's what creates regulation. Like in the absence of government, I mean, it's a criticism that people like us, I know I do get it a lot when I say I don't want the government regulating this stuff, you know, because people have it in their mind, you know, George Bush and deregulation with the banks, which was BS, but that's what most people hear and that's what most people think. So they think deregulation, you don't want government regulation? Oh my God, you just want everything, you know, be a free-for-all. No, I want the market to regulate things. I want private companies to be able to open their doors and say, hey, over here, we'll test your stuff for purity and we'll charge you a little fee, but you bring us the stuff that either you want to sell or you're buying and we'll run a little, because there's purity tests for almost every drug on the market right now as it is. So very simple. You start a business. Any one of us can start a business and, hey, we'll be the regulation in our community. You bring us your stuff here. We'll test it for you and we'll let you know.
And you'll get a big sign on your front door that says certified by Jay's
drug whatever.
Purity company.
Yeah, you could get a little certificate that you could hang in your shop, whatever.
And
you
then
know,
you come
or,
over there and then I say, hey, if I give you a little extra money, will you say that my brick of heroin is better quality than it is, and you'll say, yeah, sure.
And I could, and if I do that, word will eventually get around, and people stop using. I know you are, and I'm answering that question or that contention, and because that's what most people think. Most people say,
"Oh, that it's not going to happen with the state."
Well, that's what the state does. The state is crony capitalism that they're describing. When you say something like that, that's what you're describing, and that's what we have right now.
It's not crony capitalism. Say it
in a decriminalization.
Yes, Dave, fascism. I know.
Okay. All right,
there you go. We only said it once last week when you weren't here. I know. We need to make up for it.
You know, in a decriminalized market, you see, the government can still surreptitiously control and manage the importation, the production importation, which they do now. You know, there's no accident of where the drugs are grown. You know, Mexico and South America and Afghanistan, that grows, 90% of the world's opium?
At least 90%, yes.
Did you see the report?
So they control. You know, if you look back at from the very beginning, the first cartel was the East India Trading Company.
Yes.
1700s. And that's where the British government gave them a monopoly to import heroin into China. And so they would grow it. They used their slaves in India to grow it and then ship it and sell it in China. And they worked to keep it illegal in China, but then, you know, still be able to import it and have agreements to import it. So they wanted both worlds. They wanted the high prices because it was illegal, but they wanted to be the sole importers and distributors. And so that the governments have played that game for the past, since the 1700s. And that's continued today with, cocaine and heroin, from Afghanistan, and in the 1980s, obviously the CIA and the military were involved in importing cocaine into the United States and heroin from during the Vietnam era in Indochina. That's what we were doing in Laos.
Yep.
That's the CIA was totally funding their entire military. And that was what all the food aid went to the Laotian farmers, was because they're like, here, grow opium and we'll give you rice, and then we'll fly it into the States and make a ton of money. And so they were doing it then, and to think they're not doing that now is just ridiculous. Obviously they're doing it. They're managing, the Mexican cartels. Hey, the Sinaloa cartel, Chapo Guzman. You've heard of him recently. He was in prison, then he escaped or whatever.
Is he the one that threatened Trump?
Yes, he was the one that threatened Trump. Well, third in command was arrested several years ago and put on trial in Chicago. And his defense was, hey, I had an immunity deal with the head of the attorney general's office. Mm-hmm. And the attorney general's office response was, that information is classified.
Yep.
And now he did get convicted to 10 years. But that's what he's saying is, look, that's what the whole Fast and Furious gun runner program was there's picking and choosing cartels that they want to be successful and to attack other cartels. So we're funding them, we're buying, and which cocaine we're allowing to come into the United States, and heroin and methamphetamine, we choose that. And the pragmatic is, well, we want the least violent ones. We can't stop it, so at least we'll control it and have the least violent guys using it.
Raeford, did you see the article about Bolivia the other day?
Oh, the Bolivia kicked out the DEA and the cocaine has gone down. That may be true. Cocaine use is going down anyway, and really methamphetamine and heroin use is kind of picking back up. So I don't know how much that's just a natural cycle of the market, or is that actually from the DEA?
It was something like 82%, so I don't know if the market adjusts that heavily that quick.
Well, yeah. it was adjusting before that. Before that happened, though, Rayford's right. There was the trend was starting to, for the past couple of years now. I think from some of the stuff that I've read, it's been trending back. It's been trending back towards heroin for the past couple of years.
So you could say that cocaine, that like the Caribbean smuggling routes, the United States was able to successfully stop a lot of those routes for cocaine that was flying through the Caribbean islands and into Florida, but it just went over to Mexico. And that's called the balloon effect, and that goes to all levels of prohibition enforcement. Is you can never stop it. You're just pushing on a balloon. You squeeze one place and it goes somewhere else. Yep. And so you squeeze it in the Caribbean, it goes to Mexico. You really squeeze on cocaine, and what do? Well, they start producing methamphetamine and get it better and cheaper, and so everybody starts preferring methamphetamine. Yeah. It's the same. That's the whole balloon effect. And the other one is the iron law of prohibition. And the iron law of prohibition is that drugs become more pure and more concentrated. And that's what we're seeing now with especially heroin and methamphetamine. Everything is very pure. It's it's highest levels it's ever been, and the prices are just going down, which is the total opposite of the 1970s. You know, when they came out with the Controlled Substance Act and everything, is here's what we're going to do: we're going to restrict drugs, and the quantity will go down, purity will go down because they'll have to cut the stuff, and the prices will go way up, and that will prevent people from using drugs, and the number of people will go down and down until it just kind of goes away. That was the promise that was sold with prohibition enforcement the year before I was born. and actually the total opposite has happened. Purity has gone up, price has gone down, availability is just the same as it ever was. Our addiction rates, it's interesting. In the early 1900s, when the Harrison Narcotic Act, 1914, they espoused that we had this horrible addiction rate to people with illegal drugs of 2.3% of the United States population. And in the 1970s, when they redid the war on drugs, the addiction rate for illegal drugs in the United States was about 2.3%. And about around 2000, one of the last surveys I saw, the drug addiction rate for illegal drugs in the United States was about 2.3%. So, you know, that's that whole same rate. It's hard to measure over 100 years. The mythologies change, but they're very similar. So, no effect.
Well, of course, it's like the war on poverty that has done nothing but make the average person poorer, and hasn't actually changed the rates of anything that were promised to be changed by what they're doing, because government never does what it promises to do, because it can't do what it promises to do, because it promises to give you unicorns and rainbows, but the only way to do that is to use force, and when you use force, you end up with these type of results. I mean, what you were describing with the what happened after, you know, with Nixon who did all that stuff with the drug war, right? Yeah, what happened and the opposite effect happening? Well, of course, that was anybody who understood or understands now the actual market process could have predicted that, because you're now forcing all of this into the quote unquote black market, which is actually a free market, or at least as free as it can be with the state still breathing down its neck.
Yes.
And people will go out of their way to find what other people want. So they will improve their products in order to compete with the other people who are out there and get more customers. And even if people don't become, you know, quote unquote addicted, you know, there's a tolerance level with most drugs and most people. And the more you use a certain thing, you build up a tolerance. So then you need more. And then when it doesn't work anymore, well, now I need something stronger. So they up the quality a little bit. And, you know, with the purity rates and stuff it's exciting on one level, but kind of scary too, because, you know, 100% pure heroin can really F people up if they're not ready for it. I mean, well, any amount of heroin can if it's cut with the wrong thing. But like the more pure certain things get, it can actually because people.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Well, any of those things, you know. I mean, I you guys were talking about a little bit before. I actually did have a bit of a coke problem years ago, and that's why I will never touch it again, because I have one of those addictive personalities. And the first time I tried it, I fell in love. And 2 years later, I was like, get this stuff away from me. I can't even look at it anymore because it was killing me. But I noticed the difference when I would get purer stuff. And it's like, you know, if you're not prepared for it and you're somebody who's just like a regular user and all this, you know, you're used to plowing down lines and then you get this bag of really good stuff and you take one, it goes straight to your head, you know, you're going to give yourself a heart attack or your brain's going to explode. But like I said, that was
which you wouldn't have those quality control issues if it was legal. And that's part of the danger.
Well, yeah,
the prohibition enforcement creates those harmful effects.
Well, exactly,
it's still dangerous whether you know how much it is or not.
Well, no, it can be, but again, that's up to the person. That's up to the individual to decide, or at least it should be. But we keep talking about, you know, the word keeps coming up, prohibition. It's like, that's the one thing that, at least for me, becomes the most mind-boggling, because when you think of it in terms of a prohibition versus just using, like you were saying before, using the term legalization or illegal or whatever, when you just think of it in terms of a prohibition, like, you only have, like, all anybody has to do is actually go look back at the history books, even the government history books, to see what a colossal failure alcohol prohibition was, or any prohibition ever is.
Right.
Why would they think that it's that much different? And this one has gone
on so much
longer.
Why don't we just legalize murder then, Jeremy, huh?
Because, yeah, you're right. If we did that, then I would just be killing people left and right.
And it's funny. You know, you can talk to police officers, and most of them, you know, have an interest in history. And you say, well, you know, what about – and I was the same way. You know, ask me about prohibition, and I could tell you, oh, yeah, that was a terrible failure. You know, that created all the gang violence, and, you know, it made everybody drink, you know, this terrible whiskey, and because they used to drink beer and wine, and, you know, all these other effects. And then you say, well, what about cocaine? And, you know, and they go, oh, well, that's different. That stuff's bad, you know, and then just, you know, that's... Right, that's what I would say. You ask me about marijuana and say, well, you know, that could be, you know, that's to be legal, but there's children that could get around it, you know. And
we've shown
kinda,
that as long as you're not like a really young child, marijuana has no adverse effects.
Yeah, well, I think the brain needs to develop to a certain point. And I mean, most studies and most stuff that, you know, that's out there and I've read says,
yeah,
that
the brain
doesn't actually stop developing until you're 25. Although I would not suggest that anybody has to wait until the age of 25 before they start doing these things. I mean, I've joked with my wife and she gets mad at me when she has, cause I mean, we've talked about this before, so I have no problem saying, and I am a regular cannabis user. I have been for the better part of my adult life. Just recreationally, because, you know, it makes me happy. I don't really like to drink. Actually, on a side note, tonight we went out to dinner, and I actually had my first beer in almost 2 years. But
was it delicious?
It actually was. I had a toasted lager, and it was quite yummy.
Oh.
But that's just, like I said, that was just a side note. I prefer to smoke. That's just been me ever since I was introduced to it on my 22nd birthday. I was like, this is more fun for, like, I like relaxing like that, where a lot of people like to come home and crack open a beer after a hard day. I would much rather roll up a joint, you know. So I have, you know, for me, I've never had
he's a. He's on Long Island.
Like I said, I really don't care. I'm not shy about it.
Yes,
one of my favorite moments
right
ever was sitting on the steps of one of the post offices in Manhattan across the street from Madison Square Garden before a concert, and it was the entire garden was ringed with cops, and I sat on the steps of the post office across the street smoking joint after joint, waving at them. Like, for me, that was fun. Like, I've always liked talking
what's,
about
what's the status of it right now in New York?
Oh, I think we're still in limbo over here. They're still working on the medical stuff, which is still BS. Because, again, going back to what we were talking about earlier.
It's supposed to be legal this election cycle, right?
I don't know. I don't pay attention to politics enough to care anymore, except that where it affects me, because as we were talking about earlier about, you know, with medicines and stuff, you know, it's being used it's being quote-unquote legalized in certain places for medical use because it has medicinal benefits. It always has. They were just swept under the rug during the whole demonization of it, and then no studies were allowed to be done for decades, so nobody could prove any of this stuff, even if you go back and read the medical journals up until the point where it was made illegal. It was listed as a remedy or a pain reliever or some type of medicine for so many different diseases. But for me, that's one of the only reason it does bother me that it's not either decriminalized or even legalized here in New York right now for every purpose is because one of my daughters is prone to seizures. And I would like to have her on cannabis oil on a fairly regular basis. But that is being kept from me, or at least has been up until this point. You know, my wife.
That should be legal right now because it's legal in Alabama.
Could you imagine a police officer going and arresting a parent for trying to treat their kid, or a police officer arresting older person that's terminally ill, to go and arrest them and put them in prison. When some guy is like 90 years old or something, they arrested for marijuana. Mm-hmm. I saw that in the news recently. We had a guy here in South Carolina. Just recently, he was a retired like master sergeant. He taught ROTC at the local high school, and he started growing marijuana in his utility room, and they found it. He all for personal possession, no proof whatsoever that he sold it to anyone whatsoever, and he's going away for 5 years. They were trying to prosecute him for 25 years.
Yeah,
they gave him a break.
They were nice to him.
That's a lot of things that law enforcement does. Hey, I'm going to do you a favor. That's part of how we justify things. We'll cut you a break.
If you just cooperate,
It's not even that. It's to make make you a little more compliant. Yeah, you see, we could have given you 3 years, but you're only going to do 10 months. So, I'm hooking you up, man.
Never take a plea bargain. That's what I tell people all the time. Never do it. I don't care what it is. Fight, because that's what they're looking for. Not even just the cops, but the legal system in general.
The federal system is very different. And if you go with that attitude right there, you'll sit in jail forever.
Oh, when they finally nail me for something, I'm going to sit in jail for a long time. I already know that because I'm not going to shut up. I won't. I'm not, that's just my personality. But what I was saying, with the medical purposes, my wife, the same thing. She's got rheumatoid arthritis, and I would like her to be able to have it on a regular basis as a pain reliever. But up until recently, it was out of our grasp. And even now, I still have to jump through hoops if I want to get it. And it's like, because I want to end suffering in my fellow man. These two just happen to be in my family. I have to jump through hoops to do that. Like, that's insane. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't care. Hi, NSA. I'm currently growing stuff in my backyard because I was getting tired of waiting for it. I'm like, I'll make my own cannabis oil. I don't care. But that's the thing. Like you said, you were saying, imagine if, these things happen to people. Well, they have. People have been arrested for this stuff. It's that also gets tied into.
When you put handcuffs on someone, that's a big deal, and it affects you. It's different than just saying, "Well, they should be locked up." But that physical aspect of taking someone's freedom and liberty from them, you put handcuffs them, and take them to jail and lock them in a cage. You have a gun while you're doing it and whether your violence arresting them is overt or implied, it is there, and it's you resist and we'll kill you.
Yep. So Rayford, die. Yep.
So Rayford, if we could like put some brakes on what we're going with this conversation and kind of shift it to more of a, what would you say to like any police officer that hears this? Because I'm sure there will be some. What would you say to them as a fellow police officer? What would you say to them? Like, would you say get out? Would you say, refuse to enforce laws that you don't agree with? What would you say?
Well, I would say that badges don't grant extra rights. That's what I would say. And
any action
that you do has to be moral, and you cannot violate the non-aggression principle ever. That's why it's called a principle, not a suggestion.
Well, yeah, but like, let's say I'm locked up by a police officer, and I say, "Hey, look, bud, that badge doesn't grant you extra rights." He's gonna say, "Shut the fuck up! I don't care."
You know, what do I tell a person? Well, you know, I would say if you do that, then you are going, you're going to be put in the position to use violence and harm another person in an immoral and an unjust manner. It's guaranteed you will do it. That is your choice. You want to put yourself in that position, you know, that's up to you. But that is what is going to happen. You will, you're not going to get the opportunity to say time out. And you may actually kill someone. Imagine that. Over drugs, you know, or something that would just would weigh on your conscience, you know, and torment you for the rest of your days. To be a killer over something like this is horrendous, and you should never put yourself in that position.
I mean, yeah, people act tough, and they're like, "Yeah, I could kill somebody," and it's completely different after that happens.
Yeah, you're not going to get the chance to, like, go in your lieutenant's office, you know, and say, "Okay, lieutenant, I can't take this anymore. I'm standing up for integrity and slam your badge down." You know, it's not going to happen like that. You're going to be on the side of the road in the dark, you know, pulling somebody over, and they're going to have drugs in their car, which they legally should be able to. You should be able to have 10 pounds of marijuana in the back of your car. That doesn't infect your driving or make you an unsafe person on the road. But, you know, when you pull somebody over and they have that, then you're going to have the potential for violence, where either you get harmed or that person does. And either way, it's a it's an unjust and unnecessary conflict that's going to cause a lot of suffering.
You know the way I look at statism in general. You know, we use these terms like allow, like the ruling class has to allow us to, like, am I allowed to do this? To me, it's kind of like the way a child asks an adult, "Am I allowed? Can I do this, please, Daddy? Please, can I do this?" You know, so it's basically, you know, like Jeremy says, it's recognizing that power differential, right? The subject and the the inferior, right? Superior and inferior, authority and subject, and it's pretty childish. So really, the belief of statism is quite a childish belief, you know, no, it's not men. All men are created equal. No way. As long as they're in government, all men are not created equal. unless you can show me that the people in government are not men or humans.
Dave, I'd also say that police officers can't put the excuse on, "Well, it's the laws. If you don't like the law, change it." You know, because it is as a police officer, that bad law is just really paper and ink. That's all it is. But you bring that law into existence, and you bring that harm into physical manifestation by your actions. When you put those handcuffs and take somebody's liberty, it's you, and it's your conscience, it's your moral fiber, it's your integrity that will be damaged and suffer from it, and it's your spirituality that will be called to account for it. Because the state, you know, the state of South Carolina or the city of North Charleston that I work for, you know, they're not going to be called, you know, taken to the pearly gates and have to meet St. Peter. It's going to be you, and you're going to have to call for that. And the excuse is, "Well, I was just following the law," and they're going to go, "What law was that? You know, God's law? No." You know, the city of North Charleston? Yeah. Okay, which one has precedent?
I recently was on, like, one of these three percenters page yesterday. You know about those guys, Raeford?
Yeah, yeah.
The Oath Keepers, okay.
Right,
And there was a police officer on there, and he said, "Look, you know, I'll throw my badge at my captain's face and quit on the spot if they ever put a gun law, a constitutional ban on owning firearms." And I said, "Well, let me ask you a few questions, Mr. Police Officer. Do you live in a CCL state, or is it a constitutional carry state? Do you take guns from felons?" And he said, "Well, I don't believe violent people should have guns. And I said, where in the Constitution does it say felons cannot own firearms? There's no asterisk there.
We infringe it all over. And said, I arrested lots of people and took their guns from them. And we did it all the time.
Well, he said, well, what should we do then? And I said, look, I don't believe in the so-called document of slavery that you do. See Article 1, Section 8. That's the document for your slavery. I don't believe in that. I also don't believe that any man has the right to tell another man what he should have on his possession.
Yeah.
So you got to go from there, Mr. Officer. Think about it. And I told him, I said, we're interviewing you, and I linked to your interview with Mark Clare, and I said, I'll be glad to send you this interview with that we're having right now to him, and he responded with some stuff, so that's good. He was very open for a police officer.
Yeah, you know, well, see, that's that whole cognitive dissonance that comes into play, and that's where you get when you hold the Constitution as your highest authority. It's not this, like God went down into the Constitution Hall when all those wonderful guys like Alexander Hamilton were locked in there and touch them and he wrote, they wrote it out and it's God's will.
This is
the Constitution.
One nation under God, Raeford. You should know
that. Yeah. Yeah, right,
that somehow can
usurp when you say God bless America, if you say it enough, it's almost like you're commanding him to bless America, right?
Yeah.
And so that's what happens when you get tied up in knots, when you look just to the Constitution for your moral authority. It's a terrible document to do that.
Well,
slavery should be the obvious example.
Well, yeah, I mean, obviously we all know it's a terrible document, but I think more so...
It's hard to let go because you've been told...
Well, no, of course, but there's so many people in law enforcement, especially at least the ones that I've personally encountered, that don't even know anything about the Constitution. So they're not even basing what they think they're supposed to be doing that's quote-unquote right on that piece of paper.
Well,
doing it because they were told... They're supposed to enforce the law. Like I got harassed, and actually, you're talking about the feeling about what happens when you put cuffs on somebody. I had cuffs slapped on me, and I was thrown in a cage for an hour or so back in January, simply because I refused to hand over my driver's license in a situation where I had done nothing wrong, and I kept asking if I was legally required to do so, and I kept asking him if he was detaining me, and he refused to answer either question because I pissed him off enough. Because I pissed him off enough, it took long enough for a bunch of his buddies to show up. I was shortly surrounded by a few of them, and I really had no place to go, so I had the cuffs put on me. They roughed me up a little bit. Eventually let me go with this ticket for some BS thing that I got thrown out without even having to go to court.
Yeah, but process is the punishment, though, right?
Well, exactly. Yeah. That's why that's what I thought of immediately when you said that earlier. But directly afterwards, I went up to a few more officers and started asking them questions. And I said, hey, do you have a minute? Would you mind talking to me for a minute? And they were very nice and were willing to talk to me. But I asked them some questions. And one of them had to do with the Constitution. And this, of course, is me as an abolitionist who believes exactly what you said. I think it's a worthless piece of paper. But I just wanted to ask them. And I said, not for nothing, but, don't you guys, do you still have to swear that oath to the Constitution? Isn't that part of your gig when you finally get out? And they both looked at each other and said, we didn't swear to anything. Like, they had no idea what they had done. And I have friends who went through the academy with them, because I have friends that are on the force, and people that I know that are on the force in the NYPD right now, who when I talk to them, they're like, yeah, I remember that. So it's like some of these guys don't even realize what they were supposed to be swearing to. They're just going off the law and what you said before about how they're just, I'm just following the law. And it's like, they don't make the connection, even, and especially a lot of them, when you point it out to them, makes them very mad. I learned this again a couple of months ago when I had another interaction and I tried to ask them some moral questions. And when just because the word Nazi came up, they immediately insisted I was calling him a Nazi. And even though I kept saying, no, the Nuremberg defense. Do you realize telling me that I don't make the laws, I just enforce them, is the Nuremberg defense? You realize that, right? It's almost exactly the same thing. You're saying, I was just following orders. And they get really mad. But that's what it is. It's not, like I said, I don't think a lot of them even think in terms. I mean, I'm sure you know, you did and the ones that you do. I'm just talking about the ones that I've encountered have no clue about the Constitution. They couldn't even tell you anything that was in it. They don't even realize they've sworn an oath to it or supposed to swear an oath to it. But they just know they went through the academy. They were told you're supposed to enforce the laws. Then they're told that they get discretion in certain areas, which, again, when I point out to them, for the ones that do believe in the Constitution, well, how does having discretion to enforce the laws, how does that not violate the Equal Protection Clause? Because how can you have equal protection under the law if a cop at any time can use his discretion and say, you get off, you don't, just because I don't like you and maybe I know you?
Well,
where is the equality?
Yeah. When you have a little bit of knowledge of the Constitution, that just makes you makes an officer more easily justify everything they do to you. That's all. It just makes it worse. So, yeah, that doesn't help very much. What questioned me when I was studying the Constitution in college was that you would look at Supreme Court judgments, and they're all 5-4. So that means that four of the greatest minds in the legal minds in the entire world disagreed with the law because they made, hey, this is how it's supposed to be. And there's four of them that said, no, it's not supposed to be that way. Yeah. And so if half of them can't even come to an agreement with it, how does that make it legal? Their judgments and their interpretation.
When you run into a conservative that is for the drug war, it's like, could you pull up in the Constitution exactly where it permits the formation of the DEA?
Yeah, right.
And they're like, boo, brain explode.
Exactly. That's when they start doing, I tell you what got me off the Constitution all the way was, I know we were talking earlier about
it's like a morphine drip.
About the whiskey rebellion. That you did with Professor CJ. Well, that stuff is fantastic. But also was years ago when they were doing Obamacare, was that 2008? And Nancy Pelosi, a reporter asked her, is Obamacare constitutional? And she paused for a second and, was like, blah, blah, and just kind of mumbled something. And it was kind of a big moment. And she issued a paper later saying, yes, it is constitutional under, the general welfare and, interstate commerce. And I was livid. I said, that's crazy. That woman is nuts. She doesn't know the Constitution. But then I started thinking a little bit longer, and I was like, you know what? She's absolutely right. It is constitutional. And yes, everything anybody wants can be put under the general welfare and interstate commerce, and it's whatever they say, and as long as it follows the process, it's constitutional. And you know what? Nancy Pelosi's right. And I had to walk away from it at that moment.
Raeford, if you spend any time listening to this podcast, you probably hear me say it once every episode. Everything a constitutionally formed government does is constitutional because they are the only arbiters of said Constitution.
You're right. Right.
There's only one name on the ballot in North Korea because their constitution created it, it's constitutional.
Hey, North Korea allows for religious freedom and freedom of travel.
Yeah.
That's right into their constitution.
As long as your religion is Kim Jong-un.
And as long as you don't want to travel outside of the borders of the country, you're right, free to go.
Right.
Free speech, too, as long as all you're going to say is good things about dear leader.
Right. So why don't we deliver our final remarks before we close up. And I just want to say thank you, very much, Raeford, for coming on the show. It's really been awesome. It's great to talk to, former, law enforcement, former in any, former military people, just because, I think you guys have come the farthest from being, statist to being voluntarist. Like that's the farthest you can come, you're putting your not only your time, but your life. I mean, to me, that's pretty far.
Teachers union leader.
Yeah.
Well, that would
I wouldn't compare them to police. People who want to die for the state, come on, how can you get any more extreme than that?
That's what y'all were, I think they were saying last week was, you know, in a way, you know, people are naturally good because they want to help and everything, and that's a lot of the ideas of why they form governments. Is now they're horribly misguided with it, but it's that whole you know idea of want to help, and that's what I joined. That's why I joined, is to help others, and that's how, you know, most of the police officers that were there. But I think the tide is turning, and with this awesome thing called the internet, and people are, I think there is a kind of a consciousness turning. And I don't, you know, I think it will be kind of exponential and not really predictable. It, you know, it'll just be kind of a moment where it tips.
Bandwagon effect.
And I hope to be part of that, and I can push it forward.
Raeford, I really appreciate you coming on. It's a lot of bravery in what you're doing. I know that sounds cliche or whatever, but there really is to speak out against such a tyrannical institution.
Hey, well, you know, I, as a police officer, you know, said, look, man, I'll put my life in jeopardy to, you know, to protect strangers. And, you know, I went out on a lot of calls that, man, I was scared. And so if I could do that, man, I can come here and speak the truth like this, right?
Yeah, I mean, once it gets on Google's cloud, it's never going away.
And never going away. Yep.
Well, yeah, I mean, I really appreciate you coming on, and I think, I just, I mean, you said earlier that there, or I don't remember if it was before we were recording or not, but that you know, that there's more of you than we know, because most of them just don't
there
want
is,
to say
yes.
Yeah, and that's great. That's great to hear. I love hearing that stuff. I just, what you just said about, you know, the fear that you felt beforehand, so this is really nothing, I just wish more people saw it that way. I wish more of the people that are in your position could think in those terms and say, well, yeah, I put my life on the line already for BS, so why shouldn't I put my life on, you know, maybe put my face out there? And I can understand, because there's backlash. I mean, you see the stories all the time of the, you know, the quote-unquote good cops who actually do try to turn in. You know, because Danilo, you know, you were asked earlier about if you had seen any corruption or anything like that up close, and you said you didn't see any, which, you know, you're lucky, because there's plenty of other departments all over the country that have it rampant, and people see it, and they don't say anything. And the few that do get chastised, get blacklisted, get demoted, get, you know, just
shit
horribly treated. So they'll either quit, or, like, you know, they're threatened and all this BS. So, like, when you're still inside, I can get that. But once you're on the outside, I mean, I guess I can understand that there's still some level maybe of fear. But I wish there's more people like you out there. I mean, the only other person I've really heard recently is that, what's his name, Michael A. Wood?
Michael,
the former cop from Baltimore, who's now out speaking out against a lot of the stuff that he saw when he was there. But you don't see it that often. So that's, you know, I made the joke about the unicorn earlier. It's because we don't come across it that much. And I'm much more excited when I do, because it's so rare. And I actually plan on...
It's like a cold glass of water on a hot day.
Yeah. Well, like I said, you know, there's guys at Leap, you know, they've been doing this for a long time. And so, you know, they've been speaking out there the same way, you know, and just for them to even mention ending the drug war was just horribly radical. And so those guys have, you know, pushed the boundary. And you know, what I want to leave y'all with is when you're speaking out and trying to change people's minds and to law enforcement is, you know, we're not these evil, malevolent dudes. You know, we're just misguided, and so when you're keep that in mind with your message to try to change people like me. You know, if you come out with hate, then you can speak the truth, but you know, in a hateful way is not gonna gain any converts.
Oh, of course not.
So Raeford, I ask all of our guests this: what's your favorite quote of all time?
Well, you know, the one
have to
I
be politically or any, what's your favorite quote?
Well, you know, let me say two. You know, the one I use all the time is Upton Sinclair's quote, where he says it's very difficult for a man to understand something when his salary depends on him not understanding. My favorite quote is from Mark Twain, which is, never let school get in the way of your education.
Yes, another excellent one.
Yeah, that's you know, the hands are tied behind the back of some of these people that want to actually change things, and it's like, do I speak out and lose my job and not be able to feed my family, or do I just comply and just go along with this evil?
Well, you know, a lot do what I did as an officer is just try to get away from and minimize, you know, your involvement with what you don't agree with.
Yeah, yeah, and so I just want to finish off by saying, like, you know, you're right that a lot of people, you know, join law enforcement and join the military out of good intentions because they really think they're doing good, and it's so ironical that they end up doing the complete opposite. You know, you end up being, you know, the agents of arbitrary and destructive laws that, you know, contribute to more tyranny and more, you know, more evil in the world. It's kind of shocking.
I'll give you one more quote. This is from Shakespeare's Henry V, where the King Henry's, he sneaks out in disguise to go talk to his troops before a battle just to kind of see what they think. And he's asking them what they think if the king's cause is wrong. And the soldier says, well, our loyalty will take the sin out of our actions. And, you know, that's how misguided we all are.
Belief in authority is.
Yeah. Well, awesome. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, we really appreciate it. So if anybody wants to support us, we accept Bitcoin and Patreon. You're going to have a link below for that. And anything else?
Or just share, please.
Share, like, and subscribe,
yes.
Comment.
If you like what we're doing, just please share our content everywhere. I've said it before, but to me, it's nice to get money, but for me, it's just nice to be able to get the message out there, so I really appreciate when I see people sharing and liking and commenting on our stuff, even if it's to say something negative, even if you want to criticize what we're doing. By all means, bring it on, because we're actually, we've asked people, there's a number of people who constantly criticize us on YouTube or on our pages, and I've actually personally asked a number of them to come on the show and debate us, and they flat out refuse. So if you
have to come on video?
If you have something to say, if you don't agree with what we're saying here, or one of our guests is saying, you want to say anything, come on down. We'd love to have you.
And go check out Rayford's blog at, was it
Blue Enmity at blogspot.com and Raeford D on Twitter.
Yeah, we'll have links to both of those below in the show notes.
Leave him a comment. Say, hey, thanks, Raeford, for being awesome.
Awesome. And Dave, you have the t-shirt website?
I can't remember what it is, but I bought this t-shirt recently. It's got a Larkin quote on the back. It's not Teespring. Awesome. I've kind of got away from Teespring.
It's different.
You're not supposed to be promoting stuff other than ours, Dave.
Someone just made this one, and it's got a Larkin quote on the back, and I love it.
I'm just kidding.
My mother read it and was like, I don't understand any of those words.
We currently do have two links open for merchandise. Those will also be in the show notes.
I will tell you this, though, guys. Remember at the end of the day, and I'm not trying to, you know, kick over anybody's trash can here, I did talk to someone who said that the Earth was only 6,000 years old the other day, and I bit my tongue because it was one of my parents' friends, and I didn't argue. I said, I just sat there and nodded. I said, well, what do you think about the Egyptians? You know, they were around a long time before the Bible. And she's like, if it's not in the Bible, I don't believe it. And I'm like, okay, it's good to know.
Well. Yeah, sometimes it just to go along. But awesome. Thank you very much, Raeford, for coming to the show. Really appreciate it. So this is the Seeds of Liberty podcast. Wishing everyone have a wonderful day. Take care.
Yeah. Bye. Nice. All right, good night.
Plant seeds, guys.